Welcome to Upthinking Finance, a podcast that offers a unique and discerning view of economics and financial planning. Here is your host, Emerson Fersh.
Welcome to another episode of Upthinking Finance. It was Wayne Gretzky who once said, "You will always miss 100% of the shots you don't take." And in life, taking shots means taking risks, and taking risks typically means there's some kind of financial element involved. Now, to stick with the hockey theme, you never know whether that risk you're going to take, that shot's going to go wide of the net, go right off the crossbar, or go straight five hole between the goalie's legs into biscuit in the basket. But oftentimes, people are willing to take these shots, take these risks, because they feel they're being called to something greater. Now, Lindsay Metcalf, you may remember my interview with her. She was working with animals. She had a passion for livestock, as she said, but felt this compelled to buy this business, Home Connect, and had the support of her husband, which was critical. But more importantly, they were in a financial situation, a lifestyle that allowed them to take on that risk. Then you have the situation with Gina DiMaggio, who had just begun her work as an artist, only to find herself getting divorced and having to make a decision whether to go back to nursing or to continue on this path as an artist with the hope she'd be able to provide for her family, which she has been. But what about the case of a person who's worked for a large company for years, perhaps an iconic one, where they've built up a huge amount of success, established a reputation, you know, not only in the within the company, within the industry as a whole, and is also kind of a lot further along their career path, where they're maybe in their late 40s, early 50s. You know, they financially have obligations, whether it's, you know, spouse, children, you know, financial, you know, some kind of debt, whether it's a mortgage, whatever, but decide at that point to make a change. That can be a very significant risk, not only because of the financial side of it, because it's kind of like, you know, people who, my experience has been people who leave big companies late in life, it's like leaving California. You know, the joke is you move out of California, you're never going to be able to come back. It's kind of the same thing. Companies generally aren't going to hire older people back, at least not at the salary and with the benefits they had before. But there's also the other side, which is being kind of personally identified with that company because of the success and the you know, the relationship that's formed over the years. My wife made that transition. She, about 10 years ago, she had been working for a global law firm for years, had established quite a reputation, not just with the firm, but industry-wide, but decided she wanted to be home with our son as he grew up. In that case, again, from a financial perspective, fortunately, we were living a lifestyle where we weren't dependent on both our incomes, and so we were able to accommodate that. Today's guest is one of those people who made that decision. Chris Pelczynski is a seasoned creative director, designer, and illustrator who has spent most of his career in leadership at ESPN. Chris holds a degree in graphic design from Arizona State University, which is known for its Swiss-influenced design program. Now, since starting his career as an entry-level graphic designer in the late 1990s, he's worked in a number of numerous mediums and for companies of all sizes. His most notable and significant roles, however, were working for ESPN, both in the Bristol, Connecticut home office as well as in Los Angeles, California, where he led the creative process for some of the world's largest broadcast brands, which include Monday Night Football, SportsCenter, and Baseball Tonight. His efforts at ESPN were recognized with numerous awards, including two Sports Emmys and nine Promax awards. That said, after 2017, and after 17 years at ESPN, Chris took the leap and decided to walk away from company and corporate life to start his own business, Krispy Kreative, which I should note, Krispy and Kreative both begin with K's. Now having a much broader creative scope, Chris and his company are able to serve a wide variety of clients, including those in the broadcast world, film, the music industry, finance, food service industry, and of course, he still continues to do a lot of work within the sports world. I also should say, what's that catchy word we use nowadays, transparency, that to be completely transparent, he's also the creative force behind the change in our branding and logo at Capital Investment Advisors, my financial planning and investment management firm, but also did the graphic design work for this podcast. So it's my pleasure to welcome to Upthinking Finance my friend with Krispy Kreative, Chris Pelczynski. Welcome, Chris.
Thanks, Emerson. Glad to be on.
No, it's great to have you. So I guess the first place to start is when you realized you had artistic talent, because I know you went to ASU to get a graphic design degree or, you know, in the arts, but when did you really realize this is something I'm good at?
When I was in school, in grade school, I was the kid in the class that can draw. There's always one kid that can draw, kind of, you know, so I was the kid. The other kids would come to you to ask for their, you know, hey, can you do a drawing of Superman or Spider-Man or whatever it might be? And so that was the only thing I could do. I was the kid that could draw. So it was early on. I sort of pigeonholed myself into that's what you do.
Well, from my side of the desk, you're pretty good at it. And I wasn't the kid that could draw. So, all right. So you had this talent and, you know, you went to college and pursued a degree there. How did you end up at ESPN?
I pursued a degree in graphic design because being an artist, not really knowing which way to focus myself, I wanted to focus towards something where I could actually get a job, and that was graphic design. So I went into the ASU graphic design program and graduated, and a lot of projects I had during my senior year especially were sports oriented, which was rare because most of the people in the art school weren't into sports at all. So when I graduated, I had a friend that lived in Connecticut, and he said, hey, I've got a friend that has a sister that works at ESPN, and they hear they're hiring designers. And I just threw my application out there, on a whim, like, oh yeah, that'd be great, but how about I ever get an ESPN? They called me back not long after, and within a couple of months of graduating, I had a job at ESPN as a beginning designer. It was just sort of one of those things that happened fast, and you don't really think about it. You just throw your application out there and your resume out there, and it happened quickly.
Wow. So you had to relocate.
Yeah. I was in Arizona. You know, I kind of pretty much grew up in the Phoenix area, and they were in Connecticut. And so when they offered the job, they said, hey, when can you be out here? Can you be out here, you know, next Monday? And this is like on a Thursday or something. And I said, no, you know, which is kind of, you know, tough thing anyway. But especially for me, I had no money, no nothing. So I ended up having to relocate to Connecticut. I rented a U-Haul truck and hauled the car behind it. It was a total wreck, you know, driving across country by myself and the cheapest thing I could find. And, you know, I had to borrow money to do that and ended up relocating to Connecticut. And it was, you know, a fun and new experience to be on the East Coast. And, it was great at first.
So, I mean, that's one of those jobs where I'm sure anytime anybody asks you what you're doing for a living, well, I work for ESPN. I mean, that's just one of the cool jobs, right? I mean, anybody that follows sports or, you know, is inclined to anything like that would think, yeah, that's just got to be a great job. And I imagine in the beginning, it had to have been just really a lot of fun.
Yeah, it was a ton of fun. I mean, it was like, you know, again, being a sports fan, you go in there and you walk down the hall and you're walking by, you know, Steve Young and Wayne Gretzky and, you know, Evander Holyfield. And, you know, I got to meet Marvin Hagler. That was like the highlight of my time there. But yeah, it was like, wow, you know, it was a really cool thing because, and on the other hand, I didn't know much else because it was my first real, I mean, I worked a lot of jobs, but my first professional job out of school. So it just got to be sort of one of those everyday things where after a while you didn't really think about it. But it was good because there was always something going on there, you know, and I was in my 20s and there's all kinds of fun stuff. And we'd go down to New York and as far as the location, but working at ESPN itself, it was a good time. You know, you worked on shows, they had food, you know, food catering for the people who worked on shows, and the stuff you're doing, you know, I'm doing graphics about ASU, my school, and the Rose Bowl as soon as I got there, and it was a pretty exciting time. And, you know, one of those things where it's almost like not work at that point, you know, you're just like, wow, can I really do this and get paid for it? And so it was absolutely a fun time and an interesting place to be. You know, that wears off after a while. You get so used to it. But, you know, for the first little while I was there, it was great.
I think in a lifetime ago, I had a job working at a hotel at LAX. And I think the most famous person, people I ever interacted with was I checked Cheap Trick in one time.
Wow, okay. Love Cheap Trick.
Yeah, but that was about it. And Jimmy Connors, I remember him at the front desk with his head down. He didn't want to be recognized, but that was about it. So you moved up pretty fast, as what we discussed. You moved up in the company pretty quickly.
Yeah. I was there a couple of years as a designer, and I sort of went away and came back. You know, I tried other things, went back to ESPN as a manager, and pretty quickly worked my way up to art director and creative director. And I found it wasn't really that hard to get ahead if you communicated. Being a communicator is like the, well, you know, you can fool anyone into thinking you're really smart just by communicating well, I think. So I was a pretty decent communicator, and that was the main thing. You know, it's actually more of my organizational skills and my communication skills that led to my promotions than my artistic skills. even though I did a ton of stuff and got awards and all that stuff, but it was really that stuff that put me in the higher position. So yeah, it kind of kept me in Connecticut for a while, you know. I always thought about getting out, but promotion. And so I ended up being there in Connecticut for like 10 years.
Wow. Yeah. Coming from Arizona, that had to have been a bit of a shock. So you found your way ultimately back to LA. Tell the listeners how that went.
Yeah. After being in Bristol, working at ESPN for, again, maybe 9-10 years, I got kind of restless and I said, you know what? I really need to go back out west. You know, I fit in better out there. And ESPN, I didn't care, you know, it's Phoenix, LA, whatever. ESPN just happened to be opening a new studio in LA. And so I said, oh, can I get in on that? You know, let me in. And so my boss kind of said, hey, you know what, for our department, we're not really staffing it with a ton of people and nobody at your level, because I was, again, a pretty high level at that point. I was a creative director, and he kind of tried to talk me out of it and said, hey, look, we've got this big plan, you know, come to my office. He showed me this big plan of the department and said, hey, look, you know, stay here in Bristol with us. You're going to be the senior creative director, basically running all the design. So it would have been a huge leap forward, because it's an executive position versus a regular, you know, salary position, all this stuff. And he's like, you know, this is our plan. This is what we want to do. If you really want to go to LA, I can make it happen. But, you know, you're not going to get this new role. You're not, you know, you'll probably be stuck for a while in your position and whatever. He goes, but we really want you in this position to sort of run the design department. And it didn't really take me a long time to figure out I really wanted to go to move on for a location change, especially. So I said no. So they let me go to LA and, you know, retain my creative director position. And I worked in LA for, I don't know, 7 or 8 years, and basically it was topped out. You know, you're in that position and there you are. And if you want to keep climbing the ladder and get even higher, you have to come back to Bristol. And I just never did.
So here's a question, because that's an interesting thought that you made a decision while working there. You chose lifestyle, you know, location/lifestyle. Southern California versus more money in a place you didn't want to live. Would you say that the fact that once you got to LA and you were pretty much your upward mobility was capped, did that ever play a role in you ultimately leaving? Did that have anything to do with it at all?
Not really. You know, maybe a tiny bit. It was like, you know, hey, look, as long as I'm here, this is where I'm at. But it wasn't really a real factor at all. You know, I was happy working with good people and doing good work and all that stuff. So it's funny, because a lot of people that worked at ESPN would stay there just for the job or the promotion or whatever. And again, I envy them, because I think, you know, hey, look, if you can do that and it's important to you, you know, everybody has to feed a family. So I get it. But, you know, it's sort of like the you know, Maslow's hierarchy of needs or something. At that point, I was sort of on my way to figuring out who I was, and that was more important than, you know, just, you know, padding the bank account or having a better car or whatever it might be.
No, man, there's something to be said for that. Just going with what feels right to you, regardless of kind of what the world tells you. It's probably a whole nother topic for another podcast, but, you know, I know a lot of people who've allowed themselves to, you know, or chosen, I guess, to get into that sort of blueprinted life where everything's planned out. And I don't know. I mean, I guess it's like you said, everybody's got a different path. For me, I don't know. I like the flexibility, you know, that different choices, you know, it's not all just about money. There's a lot more going on, I think. So, so let me ask you this, because I mean, again, to the outside observer, man, working for ESPN, that's just got, you know, all these athletes. I mean, you know, it just seems like an exciting life. When did it start to lose its luster for you?
It took a while. And, you know, just going to your point about the exciting lifestyle, I mean, the longer you're there, the better the perks are, right? I mean, not only financial perks and insurance and all that stuff, but, like, you know, they throw lavish parties for X Games. And, you know, I was at a, you know, party where Billy Idol just showed up and started playing music. And all of a sudden, I'm like, wow, I can't believe I'm here. We go to conferences and they bankroll the whole thing. It was, you know, unlimited perks at ESPN. It was crazy, to the point where you question it. You're like, how can they afford this? You know, but at some point, again, that doesn't really matter as much. It started losing its luster a little bit when it started going from its sports network to more focusing on social, you know, political personalities and things like that. It, you know, when I first got there, it was like, hey, that's where you tune in to get the scores. That's where you see the highlights. And by the time I left there, it was kind of like, that's where you tune in to see two people argue and say outrageous things. And it, for the people that worked there that were into sports, I think a lot of us just felt a little like, okay, you know, this isn't really my network anymore. You know, it's, they still had some good stuff, but it just changed a lot.
Did that coincide with Disney getting involved? I don't remember when that was, but is there any correlation there, or is that just, did that have anything to do with it at all?
I'd say, so the Disney got you know, came in and bought ESPN or however that acquisition worked early on when I was there. So most of the time I was there, they were Disney. But I'll say this, that's one of the things that sort of turned me off from it as well, is there's a lot of corporate stuff you got to do when you're in a big corporate thing like that. And a lot of it came down from Disney. So we would have, you know, 8-hour meetings, 2-day meetings, 3-day meetings, offsites, just to discuss things like, you know, stuff that didn't seem that important to the job or that important to any of our roles, but stuff that Disney wanted to sort of go, hey, look here, you know, pat on the back, learn about this, it'll make you a better person, and how can I realize myself, and all these things that are just sort of sound deep, but they're just corporate things, and I think everybody sees them as that. So you, once in a while you pull something good out of one of these things, but there's a lot of corporate requirements and corporate things you had to get involved with that came down from Disney. So I felt like it probably overall was a Disney thing as far as the way we turned and the way the sort of office politics and corporate culture went. It was sort of inevitable it was going to go that way. So that was a big part of it, though.
Yeah, no, I was wondering. So let me ask you this. When you finally came to your, you know, just the time it's to leave, was it a hard decision? I mean, did you struggle with it? Or was it just like, okay, I'm done?
Well, I'll say this. It was a hard decision, and I struggled a little bit, but it was sort of a foregone conclusion. You know, now that I look at it in retrospect, it was kind of like, you can only do one thing for so long. You know, it's kind of like, I mean, the Beatles, right? The Beatles were around for like 6 years, and they got tired of it. And then John Lennon went and made great music, and so did McCartney and everybody else. You have to believe in yourself enough to go, hey, I can do something else. You get sucked into that culture, and it makes it a harder thing because it's like, okay, I've got all these benefits. I've got all these things. I built this thing up. So I had to convince myself that I could do it. It was the hardest part. It wasn't really that I didn't know I wanted to do something else. It was, can I succeed out there as, you know, when ESPN's not on my forehead? Because when ESPN's on your forehead, you have a lot of, you know, not just work perks, but life perks. Everywhere you go, everybody wants to talk to you, and you know, your friends and people you meet, oh, you work there, and what's that like?
Yeah, you're like a bit of a rock star.
It, you know, it's as close as I can get to it, it felt like it, because, you know, and again, I didn't really get into that. You know, it's not, I didn't really go around with, hey, I work at ESPN. I kind of downplayed it a little bit because I didn't really want that to be my identity, but it kind of was, you know, that's how people know you. So the decision wasn't really difficult to leave. The hard decision was to trust myself to do something else, that I can support myself doing something else, and that I had the skills to do something else.
Yeah, particularly later, because you were older at that point. So you ended up in Vegas. Tell me about that.
Yeah, you know, when I was leaving, I said my plan was to kind of get out and, again, maybe try to, my wife would always encourage me, hey, you just start your own thing. And people I work with, people that respected me, or people that I like and respected at work, would always go, you know, you'd be great with your own company, and kind of thing, because you're, you know, they thought I was a good leader, which I, you know, I'm grateful they thought that. So I was always encouraged to do these things. When I left, I said, you know what, I need a soft landing place. So I'll just take another job. You know, I wasn't ready to fully commit to just being on my own. So I took a job in Vegas at a news station. I had worked at a news station early in my career and kind of had fun there, and did, you know, did some good design and got involved in the community. But when I went to Vegas with the news station, it was a little bit different experience. And it was sort of an eye-opener. It was one of those things where I was such a square peg at that place that it felt like there's no way this is just a chance thing. This is, you know, God or someone sending me a message that you need to do your thing, because it was abundantly clear from the first day I got there that I wasn't going to fit in, and it was time for me to, you know, jump off the board or the ledge or whatever it may be.
That had to have been a little scary, though. I mean, here you go. You leave this big company with all this success you had, the awards, all this stuff, and then you make this, you know, big move, and then you find a place, and the first day, you know, this isn't a long-term solution. I mean, you know, I don't know. That would seem to be a little deflating, I suppose.
At the time, it was, you know, at the time it was. It was kind of like, I, for one thing, I thought I was escaping things like, oh, maybe, you know, local thing, it'd be less office politics, it'd be less corporate thing. It was twice as much. It was twice as bad. And again, just the what we focused on, the things we did, there was so much, in my view, there was so much time that we wasted. And I'm not trying to put them down, but, you know, just the way corporate culture works, how much of your time, after a while in your career, your time becomes more important than money, you know? So when you feel like most of your day is wasted or not utilized, you start going, okay, what am I doing? So yeah, it was deflating a little. It was going, you know, hey, look, I went from the frying pan into the fire. Now it's like, what did I do? And so it was at that point I said, you know what, I really have to move on and just listen to my wife and listen to people that I talk to, listen to myself and say, I can try something on my own. I don't have to live by everyone else's rules.
So the news is manipulated even at a local TV station. What a surprise.
Yeah, there's it's, you know, and they all, it's that way across the board. But that was another thing. It was kind of like seeing, again, at ESPN, it was the product changing from sports to gossip, TMZ type of stuff. And when I got to news, it wasn't the same anymore. It was sort of, you know, everything is sort of filtered through someone's filter. So, yeah, it was manipulated. There's the stories you see, you know, while they may be true, it's what we're not reporting on and what we're not saying and the things we choose to focus on and make big issues. News media, whether local or national, manipulates the public, I think, more than people realize because, you know, if for every big story they decide to push or story they decide to suppress, that influences people. You know, how many people are seeing that or not seeing what they need to see? So, yeah, that was kind of an issue there, too. Not only the corporate part, but just the content part and how, you know, how biased or influenced it is. And it's pretty thick, you know, there's a lot of like you say, a lot of filter to what goes out there. And I didn't always agree with what we were filtering. I thought, you know, hey, let the news be the news, report everything, but that's not the way it goes.
See, and that's an interesting point too, because, and again, I started off this with just talking about people taking a shot, you know, and choices that you make. And the financial aspect that always, I think, is a part of it in some way, shape, or form. You know, any decisions we make often have a financial repercussion or consequence. And, you know, some people perhaps would be okay with that kind of arrangement, you know, but not everybody is. And so here you are, you're at this television station in Vegas, and okay, this isn't going to work, you know, what next?
Yeah. So I, you know, after the Vegas thing, I said, what am I doing? And again, you know, credit to my wife, she kept talking to me, because just, you know, you've got all, you can do anything, you've done all this stuff, you've got, you know, 16 design awards, all this stuff, whatever, 12 maybe, I don't know. But she's like, you have the skills and the talent to do it. And coming from, you know, a place where, when I started, you know, I came from kind of humble beginnings. You know, our family didn't have any money, and, you know, single parent household, the whole thing, and growing up sort of somewhat poor on the lower side. You know, it's sort of, when you get those securities and those things, you know, things that in your life that make you secure as a person financially and things like that, it's hard to leave that and do that. But, you know, again, I started saying, well, I don't know what I'm going to do exactly, but I'm not going to do this. So I left that job, and it's funny, on the way out, I had applied for something else in Vegas that was right up my alley. And I won't say which company it is, but something I had a lot of knowledge about, a lot of people in the industry I knew, I had done a lot of work with while at ESPN. And I even knew the people at the companies they were working with, the outside companies, their vendors. I knew their vendors, and went in for an interview for this company. And it was one of those interviews that was like a 30-minute interview, and they really didn't listen to anything I said. And, you know, again, I had come with pretty good credentials. And it's obvious from the first minute I was at the interview that it was one of those sort of, you know, what you do is it's a interview for show. You know, it's sort of like, okay, we've already got our candidate, but we're going to interview a certain amount of people. And that's when it really hit me. I'm like, you know what? I'm looking at another corporate job. And it's obvious sitting in this interview, even though, and I didn't brag or anything. I just, you know, I knew a lot about that sport and that industry. And I'm like, there's no one that's going to beat me on this one because I've got everything in their job description I've got down. And somebody with a lot less experience, someone with a lot less knowledge about the industry, someone with a lot shorter career skill set got the job. And it was, again, an eye-opener on the way out to say, it's just, you're a square peg in this corporate culture. So going out on my own, that was another kick to go, you know what, here you go. Now go do your thing. And so, yeah, I decided to do my thing. Did it in Vegas for a while, and then we eventually moved back to Phoenix here where I grew up, and my business took off after a slow start. It took off, and I don't advertise, I don't see clients. I've got so many clients, I don't know what to do with them now. So it's worked out really well, and I'm, you know, my income's back to kind of where I was when I was with these corporations. So, you know, it's something you don't think you can do it, or you doubt yourself, you really have to look at what you're capable of, because a little bit of an eye opener to me that I could actually do this.
You said a couple things. One, I think is interesting about how you were raised, because a lot of people I've known in life that have come from, you know, like you said, humble means and haven't had anything, get really attached to the security that can come with, you know, the big job and the big company. And I kind of had it both sides, because I grew up, I don't know if it's privilege is the word, because it wasn't like we were like wealthy, but my dad did well. You know, we always had a swimming pool in the backyard, and they always had nice cars and all that. But then they lost everything. I remember that. I was 2 years into college in St. Louis, and then, just a number of things happened, and my dad's practice went under. The house got foreclosed. And, you know, whatever lesson I took from that, was one of them was just not to get too attached, because security can come and go. You know, that's not that for me personally, and it sounds like that's kind of where you got to, is just, you don't, there is something greater. And maybe it's, if you know you can get by in real humble means, you know, the other stuff is great. It's a blessing, but it's not like you're married to it, so to speak. So that's interesting.
I'm always inspired by these stories of people that, you know, walked away from Wall Street and they're making six figures, you know, and they do this stuff. And when you really boil it down, you know, like what I said was like, you know, I took it down to the week, to the day, like how much do I need to live? How much do I need to live each month? How much to pay my rent or pay my mortgage and all that stuff. And when you realize it, you know, you really only need as much as you need. And so these people that live meager lives and they work, you know, 20 hours a week, but they live great lives. I mean, to me, that became more of a thing that I would strive for than being locked in my office like I was over there for 60 hours a week. And then as your income increases, things like, you just buy more expensive stuff. You live in better places. So I don't know. I think, you know, again, like I said before, time becomes invaluable. So kind of what you were saying, I think you figure out what you need to live or how you want to live your life, and then you figure out how to do that. So that's what I did. I was like, how much do I need to live? How much I can survive if I do this? So yeah, when you get too comfortable, you got to figure out, what do I actually need?
Well, it's kind of ironic, you know, because when I left, I shared in a previous episode, when I left, I worked at a bank and I was doing well, and, you know, I didn't have fancy people surrounding me, and they weren't giving us food every day. But, you know, I had built a reputation, had a nice title and all that, and that security. But, and that was the thing people said, you know, friends and even some of my family members, well, you're leaving all the security you have. And, you know, what's ironic is, that bank that I work for got swallowed up, you know, three times in the last however many years it's been, you know, close to 30 now, you know, so what's security, right? And this is just another point I kind of wanted to bring up as we're kind of writing this down. You're not just doing your graphic design work. Now you're also running a business. How has that transition been? Because I know a lot, you know, people that have never taken that leap, you know, may not necessarily see that side of it all the time.
One thing, you know, that stands out is I've learned more since I've been on my own than I did in my last 10 years at my corporate jobs. You become a problem solver. You learn how to fix things, how to do things, how to make things, how to please a client. And it's been a great learning experience. I'd say the biggest difference between working my corporate jobs and working for myself is I spend probably 90% of my week now actually working on things that are important. And, you know, the other 10%, you know, you're doing your billing or whatever it might be, but 90% focusing on the things that I like doing, that I'm good at, and those kind of things. I think in corporate life it was more like 40%, you know, with 60% being the stuff that you have to do or sit through, a lot of sitting and listening. I don't sit and listen anymore. You know, I work and I do things and I deal with clients and I serve them. So to me, that's one of the biggest, shouldn't say perk. I mean, that's a main driver for work, you know, owning your own business, working for yourself, is that you're actually doing the work and you're actually, you know, dictating your hours and choosing how to spend your week in your life. And I always look at things like, you know, you have your business, and people that start their own, you know, coffee shop or cupcake shop or whatever it is. I look at those people, like, I admire those people. I'm like, I look at somebody who went out and started their own business and I go, wow, you know, more than I would someone who rode a wave to, you know, I'm a corporate exec at CNN or something. And, you know, I mean, to me, that's cool. You got in, you did your work, and you probably achieved something. But there's something special about the people that go out and they start that thing. And, you know, it to me, that's these huge teams. You know, you can have a huge team, NASA or people that build bridges. And it's great to accomplish those big things. But opening your own shop is a giant accomplishment for a person, you know. So I'm always inspired by those things. So, you know, working for yourself and you have to deal with the hassles as well. But I think doing what you love to do is basically what it is or what you're here to do. I think once you realize that and you do that, that's inspirational. So I look, you know, people like you and people who have succeeded in their own businesses, and that's kind of, you know, what I admire.
Thank you for that. I'm in agreement. I was thinking that I remember I was kind of at a crossroads, actually, when I first got this idea to leave the bank and start my own firm. I went and interviewed with one of the big wealth management firms. And I remember getting this tour on that they were in the top floor of some office building in downtown Long Beach, you know, the view of the Queen Mary and the whole deal, right? And we're walking around and, you know, it's real posh, you know, nice wood, really high end. And he says, so, you know, you're going to need to be ready to work 16 hours a day. And my brain immediately, I'll never forget it. First thing I think of is, if I'm going to work that hard, I'm not doing it for you. I mean, it was just like a knee-jerk thing, right? It's like this innate quality or whatever, just thing that just like, there's no way I'm going to bust my rear end for somebody else who's getting, you know, 60% overrides or whatever it is I'm doing and controlling client relationships. And, you know, I guess in one hand for me in my industry, I learned pretty quick. I don't know if I shared this earlier, but I learned pretty quick in the industry that I couldn't do well in my type of work, working for somebody else, because it was clear with, you know, incentives to sell proprietary products, you know, in-house funds, they pay you more to push the inside stuff. And just moving you around, you know, you establish these bonds with people, these personal relationship with clients, which to me is the whole point of this, really, in the end of the day, it's these relationships. And, you know, they leave you in a branch for a year and a half, and then, you know, pick you up, move you somewhere else and bring some guy in. So these poor clients, they've got to start over with somebody new, and everybody, in, you know, we all have our own biases and stuff, but, you know, or just experiences that lead us different directions. So, but I was thinking what you said, and I was going to ask you if you found this, because one of the things I learned pretty early on that I was a talent I didn't know I had was that I had really good business sense. I had a logic, a bit of a logical mind that I wasn't afraid to just make decisions that to me were pretty crystal clear that perhaps other people wouldn't be as comfortable with, you know, just like, okay, well, I can't afford this. And, you know, so if I have to pick between two things, which is more important, right? You know, and I just always I've had an ability to do that. And I don't know, that's just something that's, I think you get self-confidence as you go on, you know, taking that leap, but also realizing, like you said, you know, before, not only are you capable, but there's a lot more there than maybe you even realized you had before you started.
It's funny, you go to the decision-making thing. It's in my past jobs, decisions aren't made, you know, they're, you know, you get around a table, you talk about things, and people are afraid to make decisions. And, you know, in my corporate jobs, as you might imagine, I was always the fly in the ointment, right? Somebody would say, hey, we're doing this. And I was always like, why are we doing this? And, you know, half the people after me would go, yeah, I'm glad you said something. But decisions in larger companies and corporate settings don't get made that way. So you don't ever get the confidence to make decisions. You don't really make them. You make them as part of a board or part of a meeting or part of, you know, you make some. But when you have to actually make decisions that affect people and affect your business, yeah, you hone your skills and you get really good at it. So I think that's something that you sort of are numb to when you're in these larger companies. You know, it's funny. And that also makes me think of, like, you know, there's a radio host that says the bigger the government, the smaller the citizen. I think it works that way with companies too. It's the bigger the company, the smaller the employee. When you have, you know, 100 decision makers at the top and you're trying to make an impact on your company, it's a lot harder to do. So going out on your own isn't necessarily saying, you know, hey, I'm better at this than everybody. You're just saying, I can do this on my own terms. And I think that's a big deal. And everybody's got talent. Everybody's got skills. You know, every person has something they can do. And in internet age, now it's a lot harder 25, 30 years ago, right? You go, I'm going to go out on my own. What am I going to do? Now, internet, e-commerce, you can sell things online. You can do anything. I think it's really put a spotlight on people, you know, people that really have talent and skills to achieve can do anything they want now. You know, you can sell things to people in other parts of the world with the click of a button. There's like almost no limits to what you can do now. You know, look what we're doing now, a podcast on, you know, we're in two remote locations. Like, you can do almost anything you want now. So it really is helping people. This technology is really helping people that, you know, may not have had avenues back way back a few decades, can really succeed now. So I think, you know, going back to your thing about decision-making, building confidence. Yeah, I agree. The further you go, the more confidence you build. And I think, not to keep going, but one more thing. In the creative field, I find myself now, most of my clients are clients that I'm interested in working for. They're things that I like, you know, whether it's sports or this type of thing or that type of thing. Most of them fit right into what I'm interested in. And that's sort of a natural evolution of your, you know, what you're tailored to, you know, your interests will lead you in the right path. I think that's what happens too, where it doesn't happen so much. It doesn't happen so much when you're in a larger group setting with a million other people.
No, that's a really good point. And, you know, that's something I knew it was a problem. I mentioned, you know, I realized the importance of the relationships with clients, but I never really realized, and this is something I've learned in the last, let's say, 5-10 years, of the joy of those relationships with people. I mean, I just work with awesome clients. You know, Amy, you know, everybody in our office says that, you know, gosh, we just work with awesome people. And I mean, you know, and it's like kind of you mentioned, you know, I'm doing something I love and I'm getting, you know, I get paid, you know, I make a living interacting with people I really like being around. And that honestly was kind of the core for me, is that's been kind of a motivator for me throughout my life, and a bunch of different aspects of it is I just have this thing where I can't work for people and trust decisions for people that I just don't think. Either I don't respect or I just don't, you know, I don't understand their judgment. I question it. And, you know, maybe I'm a control freak. I'll admit it. I'll own that. But, you know, in my work, as I'm sure with yours, I like being the final word on what I'm doing. I like to be the one that's making that decision, because I don't, you know, I want to own, you know, I'm not afraid to own my decisions, but I don't want to be owning somebody else's decisions.
Can I go back to what you said about working 16 hours a day? Now, I'm sure you still have those days. And I have those days too.
Yeah, but it's for us.
It's in for your clients. It's not because you're told to, you know, and it's instead of being defined by who you're working for, you're defining the work you're doing. You know what I mean? That's the big difference, I think.
Totally. So this is great. I guess the last thing I was thinking that would be, you know, worth just broaching, as we wind up here, is just, was there a moment, because I have one, was there a moment when you left, you know, and started your firm, where you went from, I hope this works, to this is exactly where I should be, this is going to work? Did you have is there like a defining moment, perhaps?
You know, it's funny, because I did get off to a slow start, you know, at the beginning, and I think that's natural when everybody told me it was, and it was. But I don't know that it was a moment, but it was a series of moments that happened where I said, you know, I looked at what I was working. First of all, I was so busy with work that I couldn't, you know, I had to turn people down, which is, I didn't think would happen. And I also looked at what I was doing. And I said, you know what, I'm doing full blown sports packages for this tournament and that tournament. And I'm doing movie titles for this documentary coming out. I'm doing all these things I was interested in. And that moment kind of happened for me like real late, like recently, where, you know, my wife thinks I'm a big shot no matter what I do. But I said to her, I said, you know what? Most people that I know in my field, guys I went to school with, are not doing, you know, they're doing annual reports and different things like that, which is cool. But I'm working on a movie or something I'm interested in. I'm working on these tournaments and these big time things. I'm working on things that I never thought that I'd be involved with, you know, doing branding for, you know, major television shows and stuff like that, which I never thought would I'd be doing on my own. I kind of thought, oh, you go on your own, you do small stuff. So more, my realization has come more lately where I've been like, you know, hey, look what I'm doing now. I'm doing some really cool stuff. But you never really say that to yourself until, you know, you're sitting there one day and it hits you and you go, I am doing cool stuff. You know, my friends aren't just blowing smoke, you know, I am doing cool stuff. So it's been recently. How about yours?
Well, I had a business partner actually when I first left. This was in 95. And a year later, you know, I learned that lesson about not going into business with your friends, you know, and it was unfortunate, you know, because we were, Lee and I were pretty close. And, but I just, the way I wanted to do things and the way he approached things, we were just different. And his way just didn't work for me. And so we kind of severed the relationship. It was like a marriage breaking up. It was hard. It was uncomfortable and awkward and all that. And that was kind of the moment where I was about to give up. And it was July of 96. And I remember, kind of a mentor of mine at the time said, you know, you need to go pray. You need to go pray and just ask for, you know, basically seek an answer. Because I had all sorts of ideas what I was going to do, go work in Club Med. You know, I mean, just the stuff you do when you're young and single, right? Or become a personal trainer or something, which I, you know, would have enjoyed. But I remember I had this one night and I was saying one of those heartfelt prayers. And the thought came to my mind, just try. And I'll never forget it. It was like God was sitting right next to me, just try. And I remember thinking, you know what? I can do that. I can try, because at least I'll know if I fail, I didn't quit. And that was like the little kernel. That's what I needed. And then I remember I called this client up that I was a former bank client. You know, I tried to stay in touch with people and just asked him if he would come in and have a conversation. And he said he would. And I just remember thinking, man, I can do this, you know? And that was a long time ago now, and but that was like the moment. And then, of course, just, you know, as time goes by and, you know, you meet people in all these crazy ways. I met another gentleman up on feeding the homeless. I shared that actually in the podcast with Chris Hoke, you know, and how does that happen? You know, I wasn't out on the golf course because I was looking to network. It was just me living my life. And so it's been a cool experience, and I think that's the part of this. You know, certainly there's, you know, it's the work and being able to have the freedom and control your life and your schedule and all. But for me, I think there's been a real spiritual element to it as well. I mean, it's just been it's been a way to really see God in my life, in the way the work's gone, and even meeting Alex Craner, you know, the hedge fund manager from Monaco. You know, I talked about him with you, and just that whole relationship. You know, these things happen and you really just see that you're kind of aligned with some kind of a flow. And I like staying in there. So
I you know what, I think also I was noticing one thing. You know, you work with all kinds of clients. You work with me who knows nothing about financial, and I work with all kinds of clients, big and small. But I think what's interesting is that, you know, in my role now, like I'm not a missionary overseas doing charity and feeding poor people and housing people and all that stuff, Habitat for Humanity, all that stuff. I'm doing the best I can, you know, to work. What I'm saying is, in my career now, I can work with people and help them in their businesses, you know, and we help each other and do all these things. In my past corporate life, we just shot for the biggest fish, you know. Hey, what's the biggest company we can get? And, you know, people are going to take you to lunch. And you never really focus on the small people, the people that need help. And I think when you're a small business, you get to do that more. And it's not, again, it's not missionary work. You're making money on it, but at the same time, you're more in touch with people that actually need you.
No, and 100%. And I get calls from people now. So are you still taking clients, or what's your minimum? And I don't have minimums. I don't have A, B, and C and D clients. I just have clients, you know, and it's people that you know, understand the philosophy and buy into that. But it's just people that I can work with, because, you know, in this work, you know, when markets turn and things go down, you've got to have a rapport and a relationship of mutual trust and respect. So no, that's a great point. And I'll just say this. So for anybody who's listening, I've got about a 1 minute reel of the work Chris has done in the past that it will come up at the end of this episode that I would encourage anybody who's not watching on YouTube to go to the YouTube channel, which can be found linked to the podcast through my website. But it's really, really good because I think you get a real handle on the his talent. And I'll just say for me, Chris, as we wind up, I really appreciate the work you've done for us. You know, I mean, obviously I appreciate our friendship, but I appreciate the branding, you know, because that process we went through to come up with a logo that identified with our company and really the people that work there. And it was a reflection of, just who we are. You know, I think that was a really important process because it's initiated a lot of important discussions as types of companies I do business with. It's been reinvigorating, I guess. I'm looking for the words, but it's really gotten me very excited about a consistency throughout everything we do. And then the podcast, the graphic you did for this podcast is just spectacular. And that was such a cool process because it's funny, as a person who doesn't have artistic talent, you kind of have an idea in your mind. You can't I hardly can write. So to try and draw something or come up with a design, it ain't going to happen. But when you have an idea of something that just, in your mind, what it might be. And then when you came up with that like second thing back with the mountain and the path and my Robert Kennedy quote over that, I was just, it's so satisfying. And so that speaks to what you're saying, because it's something I could never do. But yet you tapped into exactly what I wanted. And that's a gift.
It's also being in sync with your clients, right? I know you, and I know what you stand for, and I know, that translates itself visually sometimes. So if you were some guy off the street that I didn't really agree with what your business was, I probably couldn't have nailed it. So I appreciate that. Thank you.
No, you nailed it. And it's, I just appreciate it. So anyhow, listen, I thank you, Chris, for the time, and thank you for sharing your story with the listeners. And I want to just thank everybody again for joining me on another episode of Upthinking Finance.
Emerson Fersh is a registered representative with and securities offered through LPL Financial, member FINRA, SIPC. Advisor services offered through LPL Financial, a registered investment advisor and separate entity from Capital Investment Advisors. The opinions voiced in this podcast are for general information only and are not intended to provide specific advice or recommendations for any individual. To determine which strategies or investments may be suitable for you, consult the appropriate qualified professional prior to making a decision. The guest speakers and the companies they represent are not affiliated with or endorsed by LPL Financial or Capital Investment Advisors. Individual tax and legal matters should be discussed with your tax or legal expert. Economic forecasts set forth may not develop as predicted, and there can be no guarantee that strategies promoted will be successful. All performance referenced is historical and is no guarantee of future results. All indices are unmanaged and may not be invested into directly. There is no assurance that the techniques and strategies discussed are suitable for all investors or will yield positive outcomes. The purchase of certain securities may be required to affect some of the strategies. Investing involves risks, including possible loss of principal.